Hey everyone, welcome to your Ancient Egypt test review part 2. In this video, I'm going to be focusing on the short answer questions that will be on your test. So it's very important that you study these and have your answers prepared because it's kind of like we're showing you the test in advance because these are the exact questions that will be on your test for the short answer section. All right, so let's look at our first one here. Number one, who was Manetho and why was he important to Egyptian history? So when I read this question, something pops out at me right away, and that is the word and. So really, this is a two-part question. First, I'm going to answer who was Manetho. Then I'm going to say why he was important to Egyptian history. So you won't get full credit if you only answer one of those questions. So we're going to have two sentences here to answer this question and get full credit. So I'm going to start out. I'm going to restate. I'm going to say Manetho was... And in your study guides, it has page 85 in parentheses. That's telling you that you can find this answer and more information about Manetho on page 85. So Manetho was an advisor and a priest, and he was the first one who kept written records, and he also divided the kings into dynasties. Simply answer this. Manetho was an advisor and priest. So an advisor, think of like a counselor, somebody who's giving you advice. And he was also a priest. So a priest is somebody who's involved in religious things. So you can think of your church or mosque or where you go to pray. It was somebody who was working in a religious setting. So he was an advisor and a priest. And now, so we answered the question of who he was. Now we have to answer the question of why he was important to Egyptian history. So, he was important because so he was the first one to keep written records. So if we think about that for a second, that was really, really important because when we did our prehistory unit at the beginning of the year, we learned that prehistory meant before history, before people kept records. And it was really hard to learn about those people because there wasn't any writing to look at to figure out what their daily life was like. So we had to look at artifacts. So Manetho was super important because he started keeping written records so that we could learn about Egyptian history. So we're going to say he was important because he was the first to keep written records. And the other thing that I mentioned was that he divided kings into dynasties. So this is the most important information. So if you can at least remember this, you will be good to go. But the other thing that is important is that he divided kings into dynasties. So I'm going to add that here. But if you're scrambling to study and remember things last minute, just make sure that you remember that he was an advisor and priest, and he was the first to keep written records. All right. So I'm going to give you a second to copy this down. I would practice, even if you already have this written down in your study guide, I would practice writing this down. This is the way that I study things is I remember it after I write it down a few times. So I would read through this, kind of digest it, internalize it, and then write it down one time and then try to cover it up and write it down without looking and see if you can still get it right. And remember, the dynasties here, dynasties were when a kingdom was broken down by, it was like a ruling family. So he divided it into like different ruling families. He divided up the kings by their families, essentially. All right, let's look at the second question. Number two. How were Egyptian bodies prepared for the afterlife? So just like it sounds, afterlife is the life after death. And why did they do this? So they prepared the dead bodies in a specific way, and there was a reason that they did this. So again, this is another two-part question. This one's a little bit more obvious because we see the two question marks here. So first we're going to answer how the Egyptian bodies were prepared for life after death, and then why they did that. So you might remember Egyptians believed in mummification. They would turn the people into mummies. So a lot of times we see mummies like in TV shows where the mummies rise from the dead and they're walking around. But this originated from ancient Egypt, and so mummification was when they would take the dead body and they would remove all of the organs besides the heart. And then they would put all of these oils and perfumes all over the body. And then they would carefully wrap them up in linen bandages. So it was kind of like, it was like just like this cloth. We kind of think that it looks like toilet paper, but it was thicker than that. It was like a cloth.
All right, so we're going to start out by saying that Egyptians believed in mummification.
So, when a person died, they removed, or you could just say took out, they took out all of the organs besides the heart. So they took out organs, are everything that's in your body that serves a major function. So like your brain, your kidneys, your liver, your intestines, your gallbladder, all those things were taken out. The only thing that was left was the heart. So once they took everything out besides the heart, then they rubbed the oils and perfumes all over the body to make it smell good. Okay, so for mummification. They took everything out besides the heart. Then they rubbed the oils and perfumes all over the body. Next, they wrapped the bodies in linen bandages. Okay, so then they put the body in a coffin. And finally, once the body, they had the organs out besides the heart, they rubbed oils and perfumes on the body, they wrapped it all up in linen bandages, and they put it in the coffin. Then that coffin, they put in a tomb. And in that tomb, the area where the coffin was, they also put all of their important possessions, all of their important favorite things. So it's similar to the Vikings. Remember how the Vikings were buried with their favorite items? Some of them were buried in their ship. Some of them were buried with their pets. Similarly, the Egyptians were buried with the things that were important to them. And the reason that they did that was because they wanted to get the body ready for the afterlife. They thought that once they made it to the afterlife, life after death, that all those things that were left in their tomb, all of their favorite things, would still be with them in the afterlife. So, finally, the coffin was put in a tomb. With all of the person's favorite things. Favorite or most important things. So they did this. This is our second part of the question, because we have how we explained how the bodies were prepared for the afterlife. So we did that. And now we're seeing why they did this. Okay? So, they did this because they thought the person could bring those things with them to the afterlife, and they wanted them to be prepared. And another word for prepared is just ready. So we'll just put that. All right. So I know this one is a lot, but if you understand the process of mummification, it might be an easy thing for you to write about. So again, just as a recap, they took out all the organs besides the heart. They put all the good smelling oils and perfumes all over the body. And then they carefully wrapped those linen bandages around the body, and they put the body in a coffin, and then the coffin went in the tomb with all of the person's favorite things. And they did all of that because they wanted the person to be ready for the afterlife. They wanted them to have all their favorite things with them and to, you know, smell good and just and be ready for the afterlife. All right. And also, just as a quick reminder, they also believed that the pharaohs, those god kings, they believed that they would still be gods when they made it to the afterlife, even though they died on earth. All right, so I'm going to give you a second to soak all of that in and copy it down, and then we'll move on to number three. Okay. Okay, so number three says, describe the social class structure in Egypt during the Middle Kingdom. So we're describing the social class structure. So in the first video, we went over this, and we also went over this in one of the homework videos. And if you have this pyramid down, then it'll be really easy to just describe that pyramid. So... and remember, you might get a blank pyramid on the test. But even if you don't, this will still be really nice to know. Because it can help you with this question. So you'll still have to write about it, but if you draw this, it'll be really easy to just explain it in complete sentences. So at the bottom of the social class system were the slaves. Then there were farmers and unskilled workers. Then merchants, craftspeople, and scribes, then nobles and priests, and then the pharaoh. And remember, the higher you go up, the more power there is. So the pharaoh has the most power. Slaves have the least amount of power. But the higher you go up, the fewer people are there. So there's more power, but not as many people have it. Slaves down here, there's the most people in this category. The most people in Egyptian society were slaves. Next, farmers and unskilled workers. Next, merchants, craftspeople, and scribes. Next, nobles and priests. And finally, the pharaoh. There was only one pharaoh at a time. So once you have that down, and you could even draw this on here for part of your answer, then we're just going to describe that pyramid in full sentences. So, at the top, of the social class structure, was the pharaoh. Then, nobles and priests. So how we're writing it is starting at the top and working our way down. It would be fine if you wanted to start at the bottom and work your way up. You would just have to specify at the bottom instead of saying at the top. At the bottom were slaves. After that, was merchants, craftspeople, farmers,
unskilled workers. We're next. And slaves were at the bottom. And then another important thing to note here was that if you worked hard, you could move up. So you weren't stuck in this in these positions. So say you started out as an unskilled worker. If you worked really, really hard and you learned a new trade, you could move up. Okay? You probably wouldn't start out as a slave and then make it all the way up to Pharaoh, but there was some mobility or movement within this structure. You could move around if you worked really hard. And probably also, if you were lazy, you could lose your job and you could kind of go down as well. So, however, but... You could move up. So besides this last sentence, everything that we wrote is just entirely from here. We just added in some transition words, like at the top, next, then, but literally it's just copying these and adding in some transition words. So if you know this, you'll be all set, and this will be a super easy short answer question for you to answer. All right, and let's look at our last question. What made Egypt grow during the Middle Kingdom? Okay, so a couple things here. As transportation got better or improved, people were able to trade easier. If there were better roads and they figured out a better way to navigate the Nile River, it was easier for people to get to where they needed to go, so it was easier to trade. And then if they're trading, they're exchanging money and goods more often, the economy will grow or prosper. And that's exactly what happened. So it's kind of like this trickle effect. So first, like, transportation improved. Improved. Or got better. So then that led to more trade. And then that caused the economy to grow. Okay, so it's like a little visual, and then we're basically just going to turn this into writing. Actually, let's start out. Yeah, let's just do that. As transportation improved, or if that's not as easy for you to remember, you can just say got better. So as transportation people were able to trade more. This made the economy, this made Egypt's economy grow.
And in your study guides, you might have and prosper. Prosper just means doing great. It's doing amazing. But if you just have this, this is the key information that you need for this one. So as the transportation got better or improved, there was more trade, which made the economy grow. That's the most important part. So remember, improved just means got better. All right. So those are the short answer questions that you are going to see on your test for ancient Egypt. So practice these. It breaks my heart when we get to a test and then people are like, I don't know for these short answer questions, because you know that these are going to be on the test. So practice writing them out. Make sure that you know them. Because like I said, it's like getting a peek at the test. So make sure you have these down and you will get a 100% on the short answer section of the test. I hope this video helped. And remember, if you have any questions, please let me know, and good luck studying.